hear me, right? Okay, so let me first introduce myself. My name is Sandeep. I have around 11 years of experience, primarily in Java GP, but for past 4 years, I've been working as a DevOps consultant. So I gradually moved into DevOps profile first as an automation engineer, and then fully as a DevOps engineer. So if you want to know more about me, you can go to my blog site, that's blog.opsy.com. Whatever work I do, I usually try to make it public. So if you want to see anything related, the work that I've been doing, mainly Python, bash scripting, or Python utilities, you can find all those in my GitHub profile. That's github.com/9724. Before starting with the agenda of this session, I just want to know a few things about you guys. So out of you, how many are DevOps guys? How many of you are DevOps or none of? Okay. And how many of you know about continuous integration, continuous deployment, and okay, that's cool. Fair enough. So I'll try to the agenda of the session would be something like this. First, I'll be talking about continuous integration. So guys who knows about it, we can discuss about it. For people for whom this term is new, I'll be explaining it more about it. Then I'll be talking about the components through which you achieve this continuous integration and continuous deployment. After that, I'll dwell deep into a problem that our client was facing, and I helped him to achieve a solution for that. That's when you have multiple, so when you have a big team and you, instead of working on a single feature, when you try to work on multiple features, how do you achieve continuous integration and ultimately continuous deployment using that? Then I'll be giving a demo, but the solution that actually I built for that client. So that would not be the actual solution. I created a dummy Java J2E app that I would be demoing. The application that we, so basically the integration that I have done for that client was for a PHP-based application, but the crux idea was same, that's continuous integration and multiple feature branches. So overall flow would be same. The only thing is that instead of PHP application, it would be a Java J2E app. And if time permits, if you guys are interested, I'll happy to show you the code and walk you through it, that how I was achieving all those things, right? And if you have any questions, so it's not like that, you can ask question. I'll not allow you to ask question in between. Whenever you have any question, you can interrupt me, and I'll happy to answer all those questions for you. So let's start with continuous integration. But before, I'll give my definition, because definition of continuous integration also varies from perspective to perspective, from dev perspective to other, from DevOps perspective it's different. So if somebody wants to explain continuous integration in his or her own term, that person would be most welcome. So anybody who would like to explain continuous integration?
Integrating continuous.
Yeah, yes. In fact, I would be explaining in that terms only. So basically, if you break this term, that's continuous and integration, right? And when we talk in terms of development, right, what would be you continuous integrating? So that the piece of code that you are writing, you want to continuously check whether it's integrating with all the components that your complete team is developing, right? So for example, you are a team out of which 4 people are working on a particular feature set, 3 people are working on different feature set. Ultimately, at the end of the day, you would like to see that the code that I have committed or the code that somebody else has committed is working in an integration, integrated way with a complete software solution. It's not like that only my test cases are passing. If the complete test suite is not passing, that means that the commit that you have done is causing problem. Maybe you or somebody else, right? So, according to me, there are mainly 4 phases of continuous integration. The first phase is that, so the prime entity, you can say, or the component that comes under continuous integration is the development team, right? Without development team, there is nothing there. So development team starts developing their code, and then ultimately they would be committing their code into a version control system. And once that code is committed into a version control system, you should have a mechanism in place that will check whether the code that is placed in a continuous your version control system is as per standard or not, right? different organizations have different set of standards. We will delve deep into it later. For example, some organization will say that if code is compiling fine, we are pretty much okay with that. But there are, for some organization, they will have some strict rules. So they will say that, okay, we would have some code analysis check that, okay, you should not eat exception. The variable naming convention should be good. The indentation should be good. So there should be some static code analysis check. After that, you will say that, okay, you should write test cases as well. So if you are more focused on quality of code, you will say that, okay, writing test cases is mandatory. Your code coverage, then after writing test cases, the code coverage, the test case that you have written, it should not be like this, that they are only testing your POCHOs or simple classes. So basically, the prime idea should be that the code coverage should be above from a particular threshold. So for some organization, it's 60%, for some organization, it's 80%. And from code coverage perspective, there are multiple levels of code coverage. So for some of them, so basically some people judge code coverage from the number of lines your test case is covering. For some, there is another criteria where you check that how many percentage of methods you are actually executing, conditional. So all those things comes under code coverage, which your J unit test cases should cover. The higher the number of code coverage, there are less likely chances that you will skip something and later on production, your system will break. The next thing would be your functional test suite that you will execute that will check the UI of your system and the integration point between different components. So all these things come under the build process and the testing process. So basically first you would be building your code, deploying it to some server, and finally it is deployed, then you would be performing your functional test cases. And ultimately, once everything is done, a report should be sent to the developer. So for example, let's say if you have a team of 20 or 30 or 50 odd people, and let's say I have committed some code and broken that particular code. So it should not be like this, somebody else person, when he takes the latest code, he will figure out, okay, the code is broken. So your system should be the person who should be telling the complete team, and specifically to that person who has done the wrong commit into your repository, which has broken the build. So you should have a reporting mechanism in place. So I'll drill deep into the CI components, and this is the complete life cycle that happens. So again, the development team. So now I am drilling deep into the actual real life scenario that I have encountered. So in case of my client, it was a Git version control system. After that, we were using Jenkins as a continuous integration system that were performing all those checks, whether the static code analysis is working fine or not, then the test cases are running fine, you are meeting a specific code coverage or not, then they are using Selenium as a functional unit testing tool that was testing whether the integration points between those components are done or not. So basically what Jenkins was doing, it was pulling your version control system. And so different companies has different set of rules. So for example, let's say if you are more concerned about the stability of your build, so you will say that your continuous integration system, which is Jenkins in this case, would be checking your Git server after every 5 minutes or 3 minutes. If there is a code commit, it will perform the static code analysis or code coverage or unit test execute. So at least all the developer will get notified if within a 5 minute a commit has broken the build. So at least everybody would be notified, specifically the person who has committed that particular bad commit which has broken the build, so that it should be fixed as soon as possible and there should be not be an impact on the other people who are working on some other feature sets. And how you do that? So I'll be talking about three main tests that we have done in that project. Apart from these three tests, you can have other tests. So one was the static code analysis. Second one, the unit testing, which was including the code coverage as well. The third one is the functional testing, for which we were using Selenium. And finally, a feedback was sent to the development team, whether the build was stable or not. And if it is unstable, who has broken that build? Now, I'll go into the tech steps. So for demo purpose, I have created a very simple application. So it's a Java J2E app, which is deployed on a Tomcat server. I haven't introduced any web server to make it plain and simple so that it will not bring any complexity. So Jenkins is a continuous integration server, and your app database is MySQL, and Tomcat is your web server. Now let's again go to the use case. So let's say you have a team and which is working on a feature. Let's say you have a team of 10 people. So that means that you would be working on a single feature. So what you can have a single server, on which you would be having Jenkins. So let's say we want to save cost. So what we will do, we will on a single system we will have a Jenkins installed. On that single server we will have Tomcat and MySQL installed. Now what will happen that as soon as a person code does a commit, so what client wanted, his automation test suite wasn't taking too much time. So after every commit, we were doing complete testing, be it static code analysis, be it unit test cases and functional test cases. So that's why what we did that on a single server, there was a Tomcat and MySQL. So after performing static code analysis, if static code analysis is successful, then unit test case was performed. If unit test case is successful, then a functional test case was also performed, and to save cost, everything was there. So till we were working on a single feature, things were working fine. Things got complicated when the team size was bigger, let's say 50 and 60 people, and now basically there is less likely that all the people will be working on same feature set, right? So the scenario was there is that multiple teams were there, but the application was a monolithic one. So one team is, so let's say there are three teams, A, B and C. Team A was working on feature A, team B was working on feature B, and team C was working on feature C. So the requirement was that so for different features, they will have separate feature branches. And then they will have a master branch. So I'm talking in terms of Git terminology. So if somebody has some confusion over that, let me know. Otherwise, I'll be talking in terms of Git technology. So the master branch was a production ready branch, which was supposed to be that at any point of time, the code can be deployed to the production system. Then the team A, B, and C has their own respective feature branches A, B, and C. And what client wanted that as soon as somebody does a commit in his or her own respective branch, an automation test suite should execute and it should check whether all the test gates are passing or not, be it functional unit or static code analysis. So one of the solution to achieve is that you will break down your system, right? You will have a separate server for the Jenkins. And now you have to do functional test cases. That means that for feature A, the state of database would be different. For feature branch B, the state of application, state of database would be different. So one of the solution was that you will create, for each new feature, you will create a new set of server on virtual. So let's say if you have a cloud solution, so as soon as you have a new feature branch, you will create a new server and you will set up Tomcat and MySQL and you will start doing testing on it. But that's not a cost efficient method. So to overcome this problem, what we did, we said that, okay, why don't we do this, that on a single server, what we do, we will containerize a particular feature branch. So we will create a container, and that container will have a Tomcat and a MySQL. And the scope of this application will reside inside this, so that this application will not be able to access this. And so basically, we will achieve same thing in a single machine instead of having individual machines for each feature branch. And to achieve this container kind of a philosophy, we use Docker. So that's mostly a theoretical part, and now I'll be giving a demo along with explaining that how actually we have done and what was the actual functional requirement. So there were the four major functional requirement that so the main four things that should happen, that could happen is that so let's say a new feature development is started, right? So when a new feature development is started, the first thing would be a creation of new feature branch. As soon as a new feature branch gets created, you should have a new container created for that particular feature branch on which testing should happen, right? Along with this creation of container, your test system should also get created for that particular feature branch. So let's say if you're feature branch A, that means that for feature branch A, there all the corresponding jobs should get created for you automatically, which should have all the corresponding test cases which you want to have in the system. I'll be going into details there. So for example, when a new feature branch is created, so first thing, the system should be intelligent enough. So your CI system should be intelligent enough that it will figure out that, okay, a new branch has come into system. That means that I have to create the corresponding Jenkins jobs for it. In addition to the normal CI setup, we had a simple dashboard where a user or client can actually see that what all features are there, what all features my CI system is managing right now, and also you have to create Docker containers. So let me show it to you first. Through that you will basically understand more. So let's say this is the code base. This is a Git repository. And then, now let's say we have to create a new feature for. Okay. Is it better now? Okay. So let's assume that we are the development team and we have to create a new feature for IndicThread. So first thing that we will do, we will create a branch for IndicThread. So let me first check which branch I am on right now. So right now I am on branch master. This is my production ready branch. So what I'll do, I'll create a branch IndicThread. Right? Now let's go back to Jenkins. So these are our five utilities jobs. So this one is our job, track new feature branch. So what this job does is that basically it continuously polls our Git repository and it has a meta list of branches that exist in the system. And if there is a new branch, so since it has already has the existing branches list, so it got to know that okay, a new branch has created. Yep.
Is there a custom
job or is there a standard plugin? No, this is a custom job. So inside this custom job, we have actually written a bash code, bash scripting, which is figuring that out. I'll go through that later. So this job basically polls your version control system every 5 minutes and figure it out that whether a new branch got created or not. So for example, this job ran last year 3:02 PM, right? A minute back. And if you check the console output, it's saying that no new branch created, right? We have just created a branch, probably at 3:07, this job will trigger again, and then it will figure out that, okay, a new branch is created by the name of IndicThread, and then it will start setting up all those things for you. So let's wait for 5 minutes. I can manually execute it as well, but I want to actually show it to you that it automatically figures that out. Or if you want to save the time, I can manually execute it as well. So it won't have any impact. Or if you have any questions, so I can answer those questions for you by that time.
How much effort it was required to create this kind of system?
To figuring out whether a branch is created or complete system?
Complete system.
It took us almost 1 month to basically create complete system.
So in terms of push and pull, would
full
be better if Jenkins is inside the firewall?
Yeah, so if Jenkins is in firewall, you don't have any security risk, right? You can pull from your systems, other systems. And in this case, I can't have a push mechanism in place.
So significant of Docker here is just because
I want to save
a different branch and we need a different database, right?
Yes, so basically I want to sandbox my feature branches, right? I want to have separate setup for each feature branches. So for example, that one feature can have some database changes, another feature can have other database changes, right? One of the solution is that you can create separate database for each feature branches. One that can be one solution. Another solution can be this one as well.
From process source perspective,
how intensive it is? Doesn't consume too much resources from your system. You won't feel too much it on your system.
But I have multiple servers, right? Multiple database servers here.
Yeah.
That will take
but then you have to basically figure out that what would be beneficial for you. But at least here you can have one system in place and then you can do all those kinds of things. Otherwise, you need to have a mechanism where you will, on single target, you will be running multiple applications, right? You have to do that thing. 3 minutes more.
Can you speak some more about basics of Docker?
Yeah, so I can give tell you as much as I know, right? So Docker is a container on the single. So basically, the main idea behind Docker was that it's quite lightweight. So if you compare it with the virtual machine, so what happens in virtual machine that you get a complete operating system, right? Whereas in case of Docker, what happens that you don't have a complete operating system in place. It sits on top of your existing operating system, Linux operating system, and it uses its kernel only. And ultimately, whatever request is get, it's an input-output kind of a system. It takes input from you, sends output to kernel, receives an output from it, and displays output to you. So that's why it's quite lightweight as compared to other solutions. That's the good thing about it. So basically, if you run multiple Docker instances in your system, you won't feel any pinch. And then you can have those networking capabilities, security as well. So for example, let's take a scenario that on a single system, let's take scenario of Mongo, right? So there is one starting problem with Mongo is that it starts consuming your RAM, right? So what happens that you run Mongo, with a period of time it starts consuming your RAM and it don't give you back. So what will happen that on a single system, if you run Mongo, your top application server and couple of things, it starts consuming and then all the other things got depleted, right? But as a solution, what you can do, you can create a Docker container, launch Mongo there, and then you could, so since it's a container, so you can put those kinds of restrictions. That okay, this container will only consume 1 GB of RAM. It won't go beyond that. So you can have those kinds of feature sets available with Docker.
So it's sort of a sandbox.
Yeah, it's kind of a sandbox.
So what are ports? Like every Docker image will have different ports for Tomcat and MySQL, or ports would be same.
Yeah, it's different. So so there is network capability in Docker. So I'll show it to you. So basically, what we have done in Docker. All the applications are running on same port. So MySQL was running on 3306, Tomcat is running on 800, SSH was running on 222. But what happens then? Are you aware about netting? So there is a concept of netting where you say that this port of host system will map to this port of this another system, which means that I'll say that 5060 port on the host system will map to the 22 port of the Docker container. So if you have to log into the Docker container, so instead of doing SSH on the 22 port, you will do SSH on 5060 port, and ultimately you will land inside the Docker container, not into the host system. So basically it creates a bridge for you. To show it graphically, so let's say this is your host system, and this is your Docker container, and let's say it's listening on 22 port. So this Docker container is not visible to the outside world, but what in the Docker configuration, what you can say that this 22 port can be accessed by the 8080 port of the host system. So let's say if somebody from the outside world wants to get inside into this Docker container, what he will do, he will connect to the 8080 port, which will ultimately create a pipeline from this 800 port to 2020. So let's say if you want to get inside, so let's say the IP of this machine is 54.2.2.6. So you will say SSH minus P 8080 root at 54.2.2. So when you issue this command, you will get SSH login into this Docker container. And if you do simple SSH, so you will get inside this machine host system. So that's how I'll show it to you. You will get more hang about it. I guess this job should run. Yeah, this job has run. So do you know what was the problem? Actually, I created the branch but didn't push it. Let's check github.com whether this branch got created or not. So the branch is there in the thread. So probably in a while it will be listed here. So there are other type of bridging networking as well available as well in Docker. So one is this one. Another one is that this Docker will actually get a private IP as well. So from this host machine you can directly connect to this Docker. But from outside world, if you have to connect to this Docker container, you have to use this NATing kind of functionality only.
So you use Docker in the same machine where the
yes.
things is running.
Yeah.
Right. So if you have two instances of or two Docker
two feature branches.
Two Docker containers.
Yeah.
And if you had a Tomcat instance installed in each, right? Ideally you want the port to be on 8080 because so that it's easy to write to your shipping.
So no, the thing is that inside Docker container both Tomcats were running on 8080 port.
But they each have a different IP to reach out.
No, so yes, they have different IPs to reach, but the thing is that but the mapping of these containers from the host system, so they have different ports. So it would be something like 8081 and 8082. It was something like this.
Correct. So Jenkins needs to get a hook on to the first Tomcat container to do a deploy. It would need to use the 8081.
Yeah, so basically what we were doing, we were storing this information for this container.
Okay.
The port is 8081. For this container, the port is 8082. So we were saving this information. In fact, when I show you the dashboard, you will. So basically, if you check here, so now this time, if you see here, it says that running set a feature branch job for new branch indicted. So basically, the responsibility of this job is only limited to figuring out whether a new branch gets created or not. It actually doesn't do anything apart from that. Then we have another branch that is called set a feature branch, which actually perform all those things. Now if you check here, so here it is creating job indic thread multi job, creating indic thread code coverage, indic thread functional test, indic thread static code analysis. Apart from that, if you look here, this is the SSH port, this is the VNC port, this is the Nginx port. So basically, this is not Nginx, but it is a Tomcat reference port. Sure, let me show it to you. So this is the CI dashboard I was talking about. This dashboard gets refreshed every 2 minutes, so it will take some time to. So the thing is that do you have duster? CI dashboard that I was talking about. So if you read this dashboard, it will explain pretty much all those things to you. So as you can see here, it says that the indic thread server, so this is the server name or the Docker container. If you have to do SSH on this machine, you have to connect to port 8926. If you have to do VNC on this machine, you will do you have to connect to the 7745. If you have to access the Tomcat, you have to connect to 9925. And in addition to giving the details of ports, it is also telling you about the status of the various jobs. I'll show the jobs that it created for you. So these are the jobs that it created. Right? Now, to answer your question, the setup we have right now is that we have a host system. We have Jenkins running here, right? Whenever a new feature branch gets created, a Docker container gets launched for it. So let's say we have a feature branch called init thread. And let's say we have another feature branch called offstream. Right? Now, to perform, so basically, let's say if you want to access the web application from the outside world, you need some port to connect to it. Now, as a standard, what we have done, the Tomcat that is running over all Docker container. So when you create a Docker, it's same as creating an image. So basically, when you create an image, you have an image that you use across your company to distribute it within your employees, right? Similarly, we have a base Docker image that we are using to launch container. And in that Docker base image, we have already mentioned that Tomcat would be running on port 8080. So that means that Indic thread container will have Tomcat running on port 8080. Similarly, offstream Tomcat would also be running on port 8080. VNC is running on, let's say, 5901. So more importantly, SSH is running on port 22. And SSH is running on port 22. Now, the thing is that when we have to do functional testing, so Selenium, when Selenium will execute, it needs a URL on which it would be hitting and performing all those UI testing, right? One more solution was that we can figure out the IP, use a private IP and do it. But to make it consistent, what we have done a port mapping from the Docker container to the host system. So as you can see here, what we have said that the web server port 9925 corresponds to the 8080 port of the Docker container. So actually when you hit the 9925 port of this host system, you would be actually hitting the Tomcat of this Docker container. Similarly, when you would be hitting 9926 port of this host system, actually you would be hitting the 8080 port of the Docker container. Just to show it that to you.
So the question is, like, you know, for all the Docker images, when you start with those port numbers, how do you keep track of these?
So we have a meta information file where we store this information, where we store this mapping information that, okay, for this Docker container, these are the ports.
So next port is simply incremented from
No. It's randomly calculated. So we have defined the range. So for example, for VNC port, the range is 7000 to 8000. And then we randomly figure out port and we check whether that port is available or not. If it is available, then we assign it to it. Similarly, for web server, it's 9000 to 10000 and SSH 8000 to 9000.
So you do it manually?
Through batch scripting. So as you can see here, I haven't done anything manual, so everything is happening automatically. Right. So let me show you one more thing. The port is 9925. By the way, deployment hasn't happened yet. That's why this URL is not available. So as you can see, Indic thread multi-job was configured to run after every five minutes. So that's why if you check the console output of this job, it cloned the repository, right, with the branch Indic thread. So since it was a first time build, so that's why it automatically checked it out, right? And after that, it it executed the static code analysis report, which passed, blue means passed. After that, it executed Indic thread code coverage test, which failed. And if we go downstream, so as you can see, the test case failed. It said that name didn't match expected SAMDT but was sending, right? So that means that the code in indicted branch is buggy one, the test case is failing. So let's fix this test case, and again the commit has happened, so automatically our complete CI system should run again. So if you look here we are checking the name should match Sandy equals to employee name, which is Sandy, so that's why it's not matching. So I've changed this name. Let me check on which branch I'm right now. I have to do change in one more place. So this is the property that my functional test uses to figure out that on which URL I have to perform the automated test case. This is the manual thing that I have to do.
The first job is always going to fail because the URL is incorrect.
Yes. Actually, I created this app yesterday night only. So by that time I can show you the, maybe I can walk you through the code for the branch, how it figures out the branch. Because it will take 5 minutes to figure that out. So this is the first job that I've shown to you, track new feature branch. So let me explain how internally things are happening. So as I already told you that I already have a master list of the branches that pre-exist in system. Now when this job runs, it basically get all the branches that are present in the remote repository, and then it performs a delta, and in delta it will figure out that okay, these are the extra branches that are present in the remote on and not on my system. That's how it figures it out. So if you check, so as you can see here we are saying that build periodically after every 5 minutes. Then I have created a couple of utility functions. Best scripting, one is Jenkins, another is Redis. So this is the function that I am calling. So I am saying that. So this is a complete generic function. It's not specific to this particular requirement. As you can see, here I am saying that check for new branches, whether new branches got created or not. And here I am giving the remote repository URL. So this function can be used for any Git repository. It's not limited to specifically this use case. Now if you want to let me show the code as well. So this is the bash function that I have created. So as you can see, I was passing a git URL to it. So this is the git address. Then there is a command git ls remote, which basically gives you all the branches list to you, right? And then we store it in a temporary file called branch list latest, right? And then then again, basically there is a couple of computation, but ultimately we figure out that okay, these are the branches that we have in the system. And then, so this is the file that we get. So this is, these are the branches that we have presently in the system. Then we iterate over them. And then this is another utility function. This is a Jenkins function that we have created, build job. And then we say that build this job, set a feature branch. So as you can see, so started setup feature branch. So when this function executed, build job setup feature branch with name. So basically, that's how we were calling this branch to get, calling this job to execute it. Now, the good amount of logic was happening in this setup feature branch. So it was taking the name of the branch. So that's how it will create corresponding jobs. So these are the regular functions that we have. Now, that's how we are creating the jobs. So what I have done, I have created template for all the jobs. So as you can see, we have these four jobs, right? So basically, whenever a new branch gets created, we have to create these four branches. So what we have done, we have created template of all these jobs: wrapper template, code coverage template, functional test template, and static code analysis. And then we have a function create job config from template, and then we were passing the the branch name to it, and then it was text search and replace. So all the places where we have to do replacement. So for example, if you look at this particular job, code coverage test, the replacement where we have to do. So for example, here we have to provide the branch name, because this code coverage job will check only on the ending thread branch that it has to perform code coverage. So similarly, for all other jobs as well, we were doing these things like these only, right? So that's how we were creating the jobs. After that, we have to create ports. So we have another function called get SSH port, which was creating SSH port for us. So so that's how basically, again, it's a generic function. So get SSH port was calling get port. And then we have a server mapping file where we are storing the information and randomly calculating the ports. And then there is a function create container. So that's how we were creating Docker container. And as you can see here we are doing that mapping, that which port will bind to which one. So as you can see here, first we calculated that what would the host SSH port for this Docker container, and here we are saying that create container with the naming convention branch name underscore server, but then we said that map this calculated port with the 22 port of the container. Map this calculated VNC port with the 5901 port of the container. So on the container, VNC will always run on 5901, but the port that we have calculated here will map to the this 5901 port. And similarly, the Tomcat port was mapped to 8080. And this is the base image. As we told you, in case of Unix system, we have base image. Again, in case of Docker as well, we have a base Docker image, which is used to create containers.
You keep this base Docker image within this?
Yes. This one. And this was a Docker function, so it was pretty simple. It was just taking some parameters and then running simple Docker run command, which was actually creating container for you. Another function that it has for deleting container. So once you have Docker container created, then then we are just printing this thing, and then there was another piece of code that was sending mailer. Let us see what happened to our job. Right. So this is the ending thread multi job, right? It ran again, and this time all the tests passed. And if you look here, you will find some decent information. So this is the check style code coverage. It's telling that this is the check style status, find works, And if you go to cold coverage, so this is the test result then, which with package level, percentage of code coverage, file level, process level, method level. And obviously, if you guys have worked on Jenkins, you can basically set up the threshold. So in fact, I'll show you in case of static code analysis, I have defined a threshold for check style. So basically, the build will be marked unstable if the number of tests are more than a failure of this check style coverage goes beyond 450. Similarly, it will be treated as unstable if it goes beyond 500. And this was a functional test case job that way. So in this case, I was just, okay, let me show you the application. Right. So it's a very simple application, simple grid application. So what that Selenium test case was doing, it was adding an employee, verifying that on list page that employee comes and then deleting it. So for right now you will not find anything. And let me do one thing. Let me add a test employee. Now let me run this functional test.
So for Selenium, are you using a headless browser or?
Yeah, headless.
Atom.js?
No, headless. Headless browser. We are using headless browser. Actually, earlier I was trying to do that functional testing on the container itself. But somehow it was not able to get hang of the display. That's why it was failing there. So that's why I moved it to the Jenkins machine with the headless browser.
That is hardly possible with the container.
So the application is required inside container, but the testing is happening inside the host machine. Because Jenkins is hosted there, so it is running headless browser in the Jenkins. Actually, you can't see all those browser opening up and performing testing, but as you can see here, it ran the test. So basically, there were two tests that were happening. One was that employee is added, another one is whether it is getting deleted or not. So both those things are happening, that's why it's working fine. If you want, I can fail it as well. If I bring down database, so the test case will fail. Now, let's say this development of this feature branch has come to an end. So the next logical step would be to basically disown this feature branch. So just a question. So when you basically comes to an end of a development for a particular feature, what do you do? Okay, right. So shall I merge it? So the thing is that when you merge it into a master, so what should happen?
First, you should have latest copy, like other. If other people have also branches, then you should have their update and then they should.
Right. So what should happen there? If there is a commit happen on the master branch that is production ready, that means that it should be given back to the rest of the feature branches as well. That means that as soon as there is a commit in the master branch, it should get back to the rest of the feature branches as well, right? So let me do that. So I'm merging Indic thread back into the master, right? Now I am committing this code. By the way, if you check the dashboard, now probably it has a better status. So as you can see here, it's saying that all the jobs are passing. The merge status is, didn't, no merges yet. So basically, since there was no commit into the master path, so that's why there is no merge. So this feature was also built into the system that as soon as there is a commit into the master branch, that code will be replicated among all the branches.
Is it good strategy?
Yeah. So let me explain it with an example. So let's say there are 5 teams are working, right? And let's say I am working on a feature. And what I did, I committed, I want to release my code. I committed, I merged it into a master, release it, right? And let's say there was a bug. And if that code didn't get that code, probably after a month when you try to merge manually master branch into your code, after 1 month you will figure out, okay, this is the integration bug which you could have got 1 month earlier if that code has already came to you 1 month back, right? So the good practice is that as soon as you have a code in the production ready branch, you should take that code as soon as possible. So we have a branch called, sorry guys, this job is disabled. So there's a job called merge master to feature. So what this job does, it pulls to the Git repository and checks whether there is a code commit into the master branch or not. If there is a code commit in the master branch, it takes that code and it automatically merges that code into the older feature branches. Now there could be two scenarios. One scenario would be that merge would happen automatically successfully. So this job will do that commit that merge and say that okay, merging has been done. Another scenario would be that there would be a merge failure. In that case, what will happen that it will revert that merge, send a mail to the parties, both to the parties who is working on that functional branch, that okay, I was trying to do merge from the master branch to your feature branch, but there was a merge failure, so please do it manually. So let's wait for it.
How long typically your feature branches tend to go on for?
So it depends from team to team. So let's say again it's depend on the maturity of the continuous deployment on a respective team. So there could be a team who can deploy their code after every 4 hours, 6 hours, 1 day, 2 days. There could be another team who is working on a bigger feature set, probably they will release their code after 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So it depends from team to team. Okay. Right. So as you can see here, so here it's saying that build job merge source target to master. So basically it figured out there is a code commit in the master branch and since there is only one feature branch that is indicated. So it's invoked another job to do that merge for you. So as you can see here, so when it was trying to do merge, auto merging employee automation config, main config.properties, it figured out that automatic merge failed, fix configs and then commit the result. Merge master to the index thread failed, reverting merge and exiting. So basically it was trying to do merge for you, but that merge failed. So basically that's why this job failed and sent the mailer back to the developer. But if in case there was not a merge config, otherwise it would have passed. So now it's the responsibility of development team of that feature branch to basically manually merge feature branch into their branch. And then this job will...
So you're doing this reverse merging because typically the feature branch once it's merged into the master, so the production release happens from the master, is that right?
Yeah.
And you stop using the feature branches and you probably create a new code of the master for the next.
Right.
So why are we reverse merging?
Actually, right now this feature branch is still into our system. this feature branch is still into our system, right? Okay. So this feature branch is still getting tracked by your system. That's why, so for this system, so if you remove this feature branch from tracking, then that won't happen. So for example, now we have this clear feature branch, and if we run this job saying that okay, now we don't need this branch, then it will stop tracking it. So just again question for you guys. So when you basically, when you are done with the development of feature branch, apart from merging it with master, what else you do?
Discard.
Yeah, ideally we should either lock it or
So usually the best practice in case of Git is that you create a tag, delete that branch, and remove all the CI jobs that you have created for it, right? That's ideally you will do. So same thing this job will do for you.
Silly maybe, but say if you merge your changes from feature branch to main master branch with the job, and there is already a job which says okay, if at all there is a code in change master branch coming, again send it to feature branch. So will it like go into cycle?
No. So the thing is that you are committing a code into master branch, right?
Yeah.
And then it is automatically merging into feature branch. But automatic merge from feature branches to master branch is not there, right? There is only manual merge, manual feature branch to master branch. The automatic merge is only from master branch to feature branch.
Right,
so you won't be in that cycle.
But then the job which monitors if at all there is a change, there is a commit in master branch, it is able to differentiate that okay, that commit is automated or that commit is manual.
No. So the job only checks whether there is a commit in the master branch. If there is a commit, it will, irrespective of who merged it, from which branch it merged, all the branches that the system is tracking, it will merge that change into all the branches.
But then, will it not see, okay, so there is some commit which is happened, which commit actually happened through a feature branch, merging of a feature branch.
Yeah.
Merging is essentially a commit, right?
No, so the thing is that don't think it from this angle that you are merging feature branch into production master branch. Think it from this perspective that you have a production ready code that you are putting into the master branch. So now you have a production ready code which is there on the client side. That means that all the people, all the features you are developing, those guys should also have that code, because ultimately they will be merging their code. The sooner the better. Think it from that perspective. So just take this example that let's say I have committed some code into the master branch, right? And you are working on a feature. Now there are two things. One is that as soon as there is a code coming into the master branch, you will take that latest code on your branch, right? Say that okay, if there is any integration issue, I'll find it right there and fix them. There is another scenario that okay, you say that I did not merge master branch, and probably after a month when you are actually trying to do release, at that time you would be merging master branch into your feature branch. And then there is a scenario that during that 1 month of period, there were a couple of changes, and then you have to fix all those integration issues after 1 month, which you could have fixed a lot earlier, and you won't have gotten into that situation.
Right, but say just take this period. So there is one indie thread branch and say one branch knee, which is I'm merging. So indie thread branch, you made some changes, which is supposed, and you are now merging it to a main branch.
Right. Actually, what happened in this case that there was already a commit into the master branch, and that's why the same file got modified. That's why there is a code conflict. That's the reason behind this particular change. Otherwise, this scenario won't have happened because you are just merging one branch into another branch.
Right, but once I merge into master branch, we did not think, okay, master branch, so now there is a push in master branch. So, of course, it has to push that change into another branch, which is neat, right?
Yeah.
Which it will do anyways, which
right.
is ready. But what will happen to indic thread? I mean, each ideally, yeah, of course, logically, it should not send that change to indic thread branch, which is already there. So will it handle?
Yeah, no. So basically, according to it, it's just a normal other branch. So there is no mechanism to figure out that, okay, I got a code from the indic thread branch and I will not merge it to indic thread. So that's kind of